We really don't need the mics because I'm going to be picking up like all the sound. So, just so you know. Okay, so not BB Guns Toronto, Canada.
No.
No. Yes.
Yeah, I wasn't aware that was BB Guns in Toronto. No.
Well, you have to go to Toronto now. You have to fight them. No,
I found it.
What are you looking for it on?
SoundCloud.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, theirs is BB Space Guns.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Ours in our URL is BB Guns PGH.
It's 10,000 pictures of BB guns, and then
there's nobody's liking. Nobody likes generic pictures of BB guns. But they're not like getting 30 or even 30 likes. I bet so we can easily rise to the top one post. Like, yeah, I've been ever since you said that. I've been trying to remember to hashtag BB guns when I post about BB guns.
Mm-hmm.
BB gun about BB gun.
I thought the only poopy part is that a lot of people post. Post clips via the snap, which is but depends what it is.
What it is, it ain't, it ain't.
Well, not radio DJ Goodnight. It's the DJ Goodnight Show, broadcasting live from 348 Union Avenue in Avalon. We're sitting down with the BB Guns, formerly known as Lazy Blackman. Welcome, fellas.
Hello, hello.
Hey, how you doing?
It's been a minute since we sat down and chopped it up.
It's
good to be back.
Glad to have you guys back. So first off the top, we're going to have to start with the name.
Yeah.
Why'd you guys change it? I mean, were you getting flack about it, or you just wanted to start fresh, or, I mean, you know?
I think that it mostly came from, I got kind of tired of explaining it. We didn't really get a lot of flack, but I felt there were some people that weren't booking us because of it, that didn't know us, and, like, it was getting to a point where, like, people were getting it if they saw us, but if they only saw it on paper, they wouldn't understand it. And, like, I got tired of having to explain it when it was just me. You know, like, if I'm not with Joel, it's hard to like, say, oh, well, I'm in Lazy Blackman. And they're like, what? Yeah. And then, like, yeah, then exactly. I'm like, I'm lazy and he's black, and then they, like, you know, if they think he's another, I'm with another white guy or something like that, like, yeah. Just, it's not a good look, and I just wanted to reboot. I thought it was a good opportunity to do it. I like the old name. We love the old name.
Yeah, yeah.
But it just, I don't know, it wasn't worth what came with it.
Yeah.
And I felt like we could, you know, get farther along if we had a regular
name. Yeah, I mean, because the name really was organic, so, I mean.
Yeah.
But I understand what you mean about having to explain yourself and you know, the whole explaining, oh, okay, I'm Lazy JP, Bars Black Man.
Yeah.
Together we formed, you know.
Yeah, if exactly. You saw it, you got it. Because we did the whole little thing.
Yeah,
whenever you have the context and you know that it's just our names put together, then it's like, oh, okay, yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
But.
So, okay, so how'd you guys come up with BB Guns?
It was one of a whole bunch of names that we had. We would go back and forth on Facebook Messenger whenever we would get together and just, like, throw ideas for names back and forth. We had a bunch of them picked out, but BB Guns was the one that whenever we did, like, mock designs for stickers and flyers and anything else, BB Guns was the one that we both felt, like, looked the best on something. It still had the same, still popped the same way whenever you saw it. Still had the same, like, oomph to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was still, like, really creative and unique, too, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I like the way it sounded and I like the way it looked on flyer. Those were the two main things. We kind of ran into having one-word names.
Yeah.
Wanted something to pop, like kind of like Lazy Blackman did, but without like something that we could define, something a little more generic or a little general that we could define and wasn't like, you know.
Rather than the name defining.
Yeah, because it's like controversial or whatever.
I mean, the first thing that I think of when I think of BB Guns is Christmas Story.
Yeah, not a lot of people say that. A lot of people say
should
that.
Try out, kid.
Well, it's also like, you know, there might guns come up in rap music or whatever, and it's like kind of like a play on. It's like non-lethal, you know.
Yeah,
like, it's we're you know, we're hard, but we're not too hard, you know.
Yeah.
We're not gonna kill anybody.
Yeah, because I mean, as kids, we used to play with BB guns and shoot each other in the woods and come home with like welts on us and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, I could see that. That's
cool. Yeah, and also like I think that some circles they're saying like the term BB for baby, so it was like. So I thought that was like a play on that too.
Yeah.
Like there was a bunch of things that I don't know, it felt like it was good. It was good. I like the way it sounds. I'm happy with the name.
Alright, that's cool. Now, last project you guys went and just took instrumentals from 90s rock groups, pretty much, you know. Which like I said, I love the project. It's definitely dope. I know that you guys said this time around you guys were going to use all original beats.
Mm-hmm.
How'd it go? Like, I know, like I said, the first thing I've heard was Lost Souls.
Yeah.
And with Shay Cobain. Who else do you have on in production?
C. Scott produces a lot of it. He produced about half of the record. Then also Logan Sound, Glow Phase, Jock My Beats. Mostly all Pittsburgh guys. I think one person isn't. We produced one of the beats ourselves, which was a cool thing to do for the first time. I think that covers it. I'm sure I'm missing somebody. Logan Sound, like a younger guy from Pittsburgh, we started working with, and like we kind of like it was we were able to be more hands on with the production process instead of just being like giving me a beat and we make a song to it. We like, had a little bit of say with what the beat sounded like to get a sound that we were looking for.
Yeah.
Because like trying to transition from the raw sound, which was, you know, rock based, there weren't beats at all.
Yeah.
We were just looping them, but to come from that, we're trying to bridge a gap, and C. Scott's beats were very like boom bap based, Shade, Cobain, boom bap.
Yeah.
Even Logan, like maybe not overtly boom bap, but has a lot of like the drums are like our sampled drums.
A lot of boom bap sensibilities.
Okay.
But he still has his own unique twist on it.
Yeah,
kind of like a little bit of like lo-fi in there, a little bit of like some of what he has, a little bit of like electronic-y. It's neat.
Yeah.
How was it producing yourself for the first time? Like, how did you guys enjoy it, or was it nerve-wracking to you, or like?
It's exciting, and it's not as hard to like as hard as you think. Obviously, like you gotta know shit to make something really complex or good or whatever. But like, I was trying to make simple, minimal. You know, we were trying to do some simple, more minimal stuff for some of the songs.
Mm-hmm.
So like, or someone like Logan would send me just drums. So then I would like find a guitar player like from down the street, and like had say like play these chords and then he'd play them and then like we'd put it on. But our one like we had like the I like wrote the line and like Charlie my roommate who's C Scott my roommate he would like put it in there like program it in Ableton and then like oh I'd like fuck with the effects and like get it to where we wanted it to be.
Tweak it.
Yeah, like yeah. get things where we wanted it. I don't know, it was like a very collaborative process for some of the tracks, which was really cool.
Yeah.
It was an interesting thing for sure.
Do you think you'll do more of that?
Yeah, definitely. I think it'll only grow from there. I've been practicing on the keyboard just to like try to write songs like just with the chords, and then like we can build beats around that. Like just use those chords and build them around that. Like just for me, so I can write songs on my own and don't have to like wait for beats.
Yeah. Because I mean, I've known over the years, like I've known artists who've started off working only exclusively on other people's beats until then they've learned how to use, they learn how to make beats themselves. And the difference between rapping on your own beat versus on somebody else's beat is, it can be noticeably different.
Yeah.
Because it's almost, you know, because you, since it's something you created, you can write it better.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah. I think, I wouldn't want to ever sacrifice quality just because I wanted to, like, do, just because I wanted to be my own or whatever, like, but I think it's good to, like, you really have control of where you want to take the sound of the song.
Yeah.
You're not at the mercy of the style of the producer. It's your style that you're crafting there. I think we definitely want to explore that more in the future.
Good job. Well, won't we play a song? I got Dreamcast queued up on. Joe, introduce that.
Yeah, this is the first single we released for our album Thirst. It comes out next Wednesday, Valentine's Day. It's called Dreamcast. Yeah, hope you guys rock with it. Let's get it.
Yeah, C. Scott produced it.
Thank you.
Dreamcast. It's a DJ Goodnight show. Sitting down with BB Guns right now. They're in the building. Definitely dope. Who was who produced that?
C. Scott.
Okay. Yeah. Smooth, mellow. Yeah. I like it.
He dabbles a lot in like house stuff too, like disco and house stuff.
Really?
So I think that like we stepped out of our comfort zone with a couple like more housey dance tracks.
Yeah.
And like ended up being a little bit poppy like too. Like I don't know. I like what they how they turned out. That's not what I anticipated coming from Rawa, but
yeah.
I think it worked out. It was a you know good experiment.
Yeah, definitely. I definitely like it. I just recently started dabbling in like EDM dubstep, you know, trying to mix. Cause I mean I've never done it before, but I like it. So
yeah.
You know, I can hear it. I could hear the house in there.
Yeah. Like the four on the floor, like the thump, and yeah, I like it too.
I didn't
anticipate it, but I think it was a good thing to do.
So I wanted to just take a step back for anybody who, cause like. This is our second interview.
Yeah.
And so I know you guys, but for people who are tuning in who don't know, like, they have no idea about Lazy Blackman.
Yeah.
And they have no idea about Rock Law. How did y'all get together?
Well, that goes back now almost, like, 8 years. We went to the same high school, grew up in the same town. He graduated a year before I did. And one day he hit me up on Facebook and was just like, hey, like I saw that you, like some of the music that you were posting and stuff like that, da 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 da. So like, let's hang out sometime, like bounce some music off each other. I just started rapping too, like maybe we could work together, whatever. So like, we would get together and like show each other music, write songs together, we even like recorded a couple like little whatever's early on. And then as time went on, we were just like, well, let's just keep going. We're on the same wavelength. We look for the same things. We're trying to occupy the same space, you could say, like, let's go ahead and do it together. And yeah, we're here. Eight years later, we're here.
Yeah, it was like hard to find somebody that was into the same kind of rap, you know, like people were either in like real into the trap or they're real into, you know, old school stuff or whatever. It was
especially
hard to,
where we're from.
Yeah, and it was hard to find like a good balance. We were really into like the new stuff, what was happening at the time, like. We were really into Wiz, and we were really into a lot of the mixtape rap that was going on. But we also liked, you know, boom bap and backpack stuff. And I don't know, we try to be well-rounded in terms of rap, and even outside of rap now, since. We did our own projects on our own, going back and forth with that. But we started making more songs together. We thought we had a good dynamic. We developed a good show, a live show and everything, and then just kept trying to nurture it from there.
And we've been performing with each other for so long. Like, if he had a solo set, I would be his hype man and like do it and like do a one song and vice versa. So
yeah.
Like, over all that time, even as like solo artists, just frequently working together like that. Yeah, we just, like you said, we just had that dynamic down to a point where it was like, we'd be better off doing this together because this is folks want to see.
They liked us doing stuff together. And we got better as performers, like comfortable as performers by doing stuff together. Like, I always say, like, I used to be like a tree. Like, I used to be like stuck in one spot, and I would just sing, and I would always worry about my breath control or whatever.
I'd be the one that was all over the place.
Maybe like
and,
dancing,
jumping off the stage
yeah.
and dancing and all sorts
yeah,
of stuff.
Yeah, but then like we started getting like, I don't know, a little more crazy and like instead of being, I don't know, because like I think we were like a little cheesier before. Like,
yeah.
And like now we try to be cool, like balance all those things, because you can do too much too. Like some people,
yeah.
I think, try hard.
To be extra,
entertaining or over the top, and it's, you know, it's got to like come naturally at the same time.
Yeah.
You can't just force being having that energy. It just kind of happens, and I don't know. We've been doing this for a while, so I think, you know, it shows in some ways like that.
Okay, so you guys have an event that you do monthly.
Yeah.
Rap Again Fascism.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about it.
Well, that was, rap started as an idea between JP and Young Mulatto, RIP Young Mulatto, just to try to, as a way to bring folks from various sides of like the Pittsburgh rap scene together on the one show, give people some chances that may not have chances, like going other places, or may have certain barriers depending on, like, you know, like what certain promoters' tactics might be or whatever, whatever. And we take the proceeds from that and we donate it to the Afro-American Music Institute. We did it 3 or 4 of them straight. We did 3 of them straight and took a break for the holidays and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're not doing one this month because we have like the album rollout and like all these things going on. So, but next month we'll be back third, and it's the third Thursday of the month.
Okay, Mr. Roboto's?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Mr.
Roboto
Project.
Yeah.
Bloomfield.
So, how is that been? I haven't been there yet. I mean, I know it's been around for a while because it used to be in Wilkinsburg.
Yeah, I know a lot of people that were in like the punk and like the hardcore metal scene that used to go to shows there. Like,
yeah.
We talked about it all the time. It's a nice space. It's like a kind of like a community center sort of thing.
Uh-huh.
It's decent sized, but it's like nice and cozy and it's still like intimate. So you have shows in there and you can really feel the energy from people. We can really like go ahead and get into it. It's a nice spot.
Yeah, and it's all ages, which is important too. And I think
you're gonna bring the kids
up.
We
were doing a lot of shows that were 21 and up for a while. And we were so concerned with doing, bars or venues with alcohol, like we didn't think we could get people if we didn't have booze. But actually, there's a lot of young people and a lot of the new young artists, like their friends, they want to be able to bring them. And if it's 21 and up, they can't come.
Mm-hmm.
And I see that, and that's what's great about Roboto's. It's all ages. It's a nice place. You know, it's a really good atmosphere. It's mostly rock stuff there, obviously.
Yeah.
Indie rock kinds of things, punk kinds of things. But they want more other stuff, as long as it's cool and if people respect the place, they're all about whatever they got. Well, that's what they wanted to bring, Raph there, because they wanted to be more inclusive and that's what, I think it's important, because a lot of venues, I think that used to be a problem.
Yeah.
Where it was like, places
definitely
didn't want anything else, but I like that about it. There's a lot of good people running it, like that really have, good hearts and intentions and stuff, and that's important.
Yeah, because I mean, I did probably maybe 10 or 12 shows at Smiling Moose since 2016. I didn't do any in 2017 because same people, same crowd, and really the demographic that you need for local hip hop is 18 and over.
Yeah, exactly.
I've been looking for 18 and over venues to start doing shows.
Yeah.
So I'll definitely check them out.
Another big thing that's been that's happened in the last couple of years is the house venue scene. A lot in Oakland and other places is that you have people that are just have regular basement shows,
mm-hmm.
And like house party kind of shows. But even though if they're in the regular, they're in the middle of the week, it's not like people are partying. It's just there for a show, regular show.
Mm-hmm. Coming off the street, even if you know or see someone post about it or something, you can get the address or go to it. Just coming off the street, throw your five down, come in, listen to some tunes, and then just bounce out.
It's pretty cool. The college kids are kind of plugged into it, like you pit.
Yeah.
And it's good to see get new faces to see. And that's what our approach always has been, do different kinds of shows.
Yeah.
To not do just hip hop shows or just rock shows or just whatever. Because there's so many different little pockets and scenes in the city in all the genres. And I think it's important to maximize your exposure to go to do them all.
Yeah, definitely. Well, while we play some more music, I got Willow queued up. This is Willow from BB Guns.
Produced by C. Scott.
Produced by C. Scott.
I'm not
shot me, nigga.